Here.
Alderman Kramer?
Present.
Alderman Tui? Alderman Leahy? Alderwoman Manister? Alderwoman Saunders?
Here.
By my count, that's four. Is anybody else coming?
I believe you can count as the fifth.
No.
No.
By ordinance, we're not allowed to meet.
Cindy will be here in 10 minutes, so we will wait. And in the meantime...
Well, we're not going to wait. We're... The meeting's been called to order. We don't have a quorum. We can't meet. It's by ordinance. It's by ordinance.
But we've placed the starting time on hold. We've waited for other aldermen in the past, so we can...
So if you'd like to make a motion to adjourn...
I would like to make a motion that we wait until Cindy Manister arrives.
Going to recess. I'll second that motion.
Is there any discussion?
I would just like to mention that we had planned on having dinner, so we will recess for dinner.
Yeah, that's not discussion related to the motion, so is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Great, we'll be in recess for 10 minutes.
Yeah, well, we didn't make the motion with the timeframe. Yes, there's pizza and salads in the back room. If we run out, I can order more. I wasn't certain about the attendance. I have emailed about this meeting for 2 days and received no response from BOLA, city staff, nor the mayor regarding this meeting. So he decided he would show up tonight, and I'm glad to have him here. So please help yourself for dinner. Thank you.
It's in the conference room.
How are you doing? Oh, hey. Well, that's true. I said in the emails and I said to anybody who would listen, I thought it was worthwhile. And I still think it's worthwhile. I don't understand the level of acrimony.
I don't really understand that.
Hello. Hey, daughter. How are you? Good, what's going on? You're where? Oh. Okay. Oh, I see. Okay. So am I getting a suit for the wedding? Oh, I'm not wearing a tuxedo? Okay. That's fine. Yeah, that's okay. Whatever you want. I just assumed it was a... I was wearing a tuxedo, but I'll wear... Oh, okay. I mean, is it black? Does it have to be the same? What is that? How's it different from mine? Okay. It's just a regular...
There is. Yeah, it's just 5 inches.
It does...
it's a brief one.
Part of it.
Yeah. I mean...
Part of it is shiny, but part of it is regular. I think the back of it might be... I can't remember. I can't remember what's what.
Oh, are you serious? Oh, you won't be answering. Because I thought I was going to be late. She's going to
break up. Okay, so the jacket, I mean, let's see. Can you take a picture of the jacket and I'll look at it and see if I can compare it? Well, compare it. Let's... Can you take a... do you have a stripe down the side of the pants?
He's waiting on me.
You were going to have thermonuclear war if you hadn't showed up.
Oh, jeez. Okay. Are we wearing black bow ties? Are we wearing black strip, regular ties?
I'm
Just a regular tie, not a bow tie.
Calm down.
Okay. That's got, so I need that at least. Well. Okay. Well, if you that's what you decide, you talk to your mom and we'll I'll get it worked out. I'll make it work. I'm not renting from them. I'm buying, right? Right? Renting. Ugh. I want to wear a suit I own, not a suit that I'm renting. No, it's okay. I'm not trying to make this more difficult for you. No, I'm at Brentwood. We're in the middle of a special meeting. Yeah. We're in recess right now. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So how does Connor get his fitted? How does Connor get his fitted? Is there one in South Carolina? Can you ask them? If there's one near Charleston?
I told him I don't think I can ever pay for Starbucks.
Well, I know he can look it up too.
There is a phone now.
All right,
so,
love you.
Yeah, so Cindy Manister got here.
All right, bye.
And then, you know, as long as everyone's paid, we should be good. I don't know how it's going to jump back in exactly, but we'll see. Do you have to vote to go back in or something?
Yeah, you
start.
I wonder if Cindy knows her.
There you go.
She's in Ward 2. I wonder if Cindy knows her.
Yeah.
You don't know Karen Blair. Those aren't mine.
Did you see this? So last month we voted to So I reached out to her today and I talked to Chief Jury again. What she was hoping for was, if this is Woodsy and this is Pine and this is Memorial Park, she was hoping for some places to park along here, even though it's on the east side, kind of where the walking entrance is in the memorial. And I said to her, well, if somebody parks between these driveways and this fire hydrant, they're never going to be able to get in. And she goes, well, nobody ever parks there. And I said, well, maybe true that nobody ever.
One day they do.
There. Right. So
I've had a lot of correspondence with Karen, and she's very involved.
and I didn't address it because I haven't had time actually, but I was just going to call her. But I'll call her.
Okay. Well, and I didn't want to leave it with her. I mean, I left it with her kind of like, look, I just respect her.
Okay, looks like we got some people now.
Yes, sir.
It'll work.
You know, on that one occasion that the car somebody does park in the location, it could
Can we make a motion tonight to go out of Robert's Rules of Order?
You can make a motion to proceed informally if you like.
Yeah.
So that's why they changed it.
Okay, I'm going to call the meeting back to order. It's 6:45. Item number 4 on the agenda, discussion continuing regarding compensation and benefits.
Motion?
Alderwoman Saunders.
I make a motion that we go out of Robert's Rules of Order for this meeting, just as we did at the last workman's, the last compensation meeting. It's an informal meeting for us to discuss the compensation plan, and we'll move to the table.
Okay.
So,
I believe the motion you want is the motion to proceed informally?
Yes, proceed informally.
Second.
Well, I guess I'm just going to add to that. I don't want to do it at the table because we're on tape tonight, and it won't be possible to do the videotaping properly at the table, so we'll stay at the dais. Motion to proceed informally is before the board. It's been seconded. Is there any discussion? Alderman Saunders.
It would have been nice if we would have known that the recorder for the table wasn't going to be provided.
Is this related to the motion?
Yes, it is.
I don't think so. Any other discussion?
Well, part of the motion was to move to the table.
I'm sorry, it's not part of the motion. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Great, we'll proceed informally.
Okay, well, I'll take the lead from that.
Your Honor, with the last meeting, we had a easel with some bullet points that we had come to conclusion on. Do we know if that is in the building anywhere accessible?
I don't.
Okay.
Okay. First of all, for parties here that are new to the meeting and
I'm sorry, you'd need to address your comments to the board.
Okay.
And just as a reminder to everybody in the audience this evening, excuse me, just as a reminder to everybody in the audience this evening, we are proceeding informally under Robert's Rules of Order. That doesn't mean that you are part of the discussion. It means that the Board of Aldermen will be having discussion without formalities. So please abstain from taking any part in the discussion. And the Aldermen, I'd like to remind you to direct your remarks and comments to each other, not to any member of the audience, please. Thank you.
Thank you for that update. Okay, so I requested this meeting. We were supposed to meet September 2nd, as all of you know, and it would have been the same 5 Aldermen that showed up for this meeting that would have been at that meeting. And the meeting was scheduled, materials delivered Tuesday, still knowing we're down 3 people, and then that Wednesday when we had the meeting, it was canceled 1:15 or so in the afternoon, and one alderman actually had gone out there, although he was already out there, so he had gone over to the site, but the meeting was canceled at the last minute. So then I asked at the last Board of Aldermen meeting, just in case you guys, I know at the end of the meetings get tired, I asked when we were going to do the second follow-up workshop, and staff did not contribute anything, and Mayor Thornton said something to the effect of, good luck getting 7 of us together. Well, ideally 7 would be great, 8 would be better, but unfortunately it's difficult enough to get 5 members together for a meeting. So when you have a quorum, I think you have to take advantage of that. So my husband attended the mayor's coffee and asked what his top priority was, top priorities, and number 1 was compensation. And so when he came home and told me that, I thought, you know what? Let's strike while the iron's hot and call a meeting so we can move forward with this compensation study that we paid $30,000 for. We were supposed to receive it in September of 2014 in time for that budget for preparing the 2015 budget. Some of the newer aldermen may not know that. And since we got it at the end of November, as aldermen, we decided that there was no way that we could make pay decisions with that short a time. There was too much information, so we decided to postpone using the information from the compensation study and approve 3% raises as was done in the last few years, and that we would make it a top priority for this year. well, once again, here we are, we're up against the budget deadline, and we haven't gotten through the compensation workshop, work information at all. So anyway, the hope of this was not to be adversarial, it was just to hurry up and let's get this stuff done so we can move on to some other issues, but also respect the residents' tax dollars, actually go through the information that we received from the compensation survey and decide whether or not we find it beneficial in revising our pay plan, devising a pay plan, or what we want to do. So this is the continuation of that. I'm going to pass out some talking points. There's not more. If somebody wanted to make a copy, take one of ours and make it.
Please address your remarks to the Board of Aldermen.
Oh, if the Aldermen would like copies made for the, I have no opposition to that. Okay, so this was just kind of a overview of the way I was hoping that the conversation would go tonight. And just to make it concise and move us along and keep us on task. And hopefully, you know, be able to come with some consensus or at least concise questions of what we need to move forward with the information. So the first thing was longevity pay. At the last meeting, we said we were going to add longevity pay to the 2015 base and then no longer and then discontinue longevity pay. I just want to reaffirm, because that was kind of towards the end of the meeting, everybody was getting tired, and I want to reaffirm that everyone understands that. The thinking behind it was, instead of cutting, then at least it would be part of the base pay, and then also then would have impact on hourly rates, pensions, so forth. So at least in some ways it would be built in, but no other city, other cities are not continuing to do longevity pay. One or two may have it grandfathered in. And part of the reason of going to a step pay is to get you to top pay in a rather quick manner. The thinking is, if you're already getting top pay before most people would in their career time, then additional incentive to stay is not needed. That was the thinking, and in the original plan, the compensation consultant had recommended ending longevity pay. Discussion.
Maureen, we had the conversation at the last workshop about the difference between the, you had the step plan and the non-step plan, the ranges. So when you're talking about the 2015 base pay, that's regardless of whether we're talking about step plans,
yes,
or ranges.
This is just a one-time thing this year. Wherever you are, if you're at the $1,500 bonus or you're at the $300 mark in the bonus, it will be added to your current base pay. And then from then on, the benefit will no longer be
2016, no more.
Right.
I feel like I remember there was a consensus in that regard.
There was, but I just wanted to just make sure that everyone understood how it was working. Is there anyone that doesn't recall that being the case? Okay. So that's what we had agreed on at the end of last week, along with 75 percentile. The next question was internal equity versus no internal equity. And you should have been supplied with some information from Linda Higby and staff regarding that. And I'll have some more material in a minute since the last meeting. To us, because we asked for additional information at the last meeting regarding internal equity.
Yes,
I remember asking about it.
Okay. It was in my
Did you have it?
I have the one.
Did we get it delivered to us?
Right? What was the other?
It was two pages, right?
Two pages? Oh, I don't have the other page. Oh, yes, I do.
Okay. Well, I can share with you.
Oh, wait.
The workshop follow up.
Okay, if you can maybe share with Tom so that David has yours.
Thank you.
Did you get that?
No, I actually, I think I did. I didn't bring it with me tonight, but I didn't understand. Maureen, this extra third page is what?
Okay, then maybe I don't have that one.
No, this is third page.
Is this the third page?
This is what you're talking
yes.
about?
Yes.
That I just prepared.
Okay.
That wasn't from staff, from staff or
okay.
Linda Higby. So you can see from here what this spreadsheet does is it lists the positions that are going to be changed as a result of internal equity versus no internal equity. So you can see what the top of grade will be with internal equity and what the grade is with no internal equity. And the first one where there's no internal equity is where the market places the position. The other with internal equity is where Brentwood places the position. And so as you can see, it takes some positions down and it moves some positions up considerably. And my feeling is that the market, once again, the market will drive the positions to where they need to be. So if there is inequity, that will happen naturally by the market. So as what the position that was being discussed at the last meeting was fire captain, was just one that was taken out, was pay parallel with police sergeant lieutenant, but that is with internal equity going to be taken up $8,300 to put them at a different grade level. And the thinking there is that the market values that position at a higher grade than the police sergeant lieutenant. But I think if you look at the data, that's not necessarily correct. With what she, Linda Higby, provided you, it says that four of the eight comparators with both roles place the captain higher, two have the roles equivalent to one another, and two have the sergeant higher than the captain. So what I'm thinking is one, if that is the way it is, we're freezing pay anyway because we pay higher than market. The market will take care of that. But the other way to look at it too, though, is that if we decide, and in the past, that was a spoken philosophy, I'm not certain because I've only been here on my fourth year, but that there would be pay parity between the police and the fire department. And now it seems as though, based on what staff recommended and the consultant, that may not necessarily be a value that we want to have. But regardless, the position that we're paying is already, fire captain's already higher than the market, so if we're gonna go ahead and move it further over, that to me, doesn't seem fair. I mean, in one swoop, that position will make up more than the 8% that was withheld over the past. And, you know, again, I mean, if we're going to move to that position, then subtract the 8%. I mean, I don't know. But to me, based on the data that we have, keeping using the no internal equity, the positions are all still going to be at the top of market. And then as the market changes and pulls them apart, because we'll regularly be updating the steps as in comparison to the market. And right now we have, you know, the top step, but if the market continues to grow, which that's what we're hoping for everyone, we will adjust those steps accordingly, and those positions will move with the market.
Let me ask a question real quick. It strikes me as opposite of logic to decide about philosophically whether we believe or don't believe in internal equity by beginning the process by discussing what effect it's going to have on the salaries of our employees, and then deciding based on the effect of these changes whether it's a good idea for Brentwood or a bad idea for Brentwood. It seems to me, and it strikes me, that this was the recommendation from Linda at the workshop, that we would be encouraged to talk about the notion of internal equity as an abstract concept rather than how it actually applies to the city of Brentwood, and then as a result of that application decide, oh yeah, that's something we want to do or that's something we don't want to do. That's just my opinion, but it seems to me that discussion, starting with the potential changes brought about by the use of it or the non-use of it, just strikes me as the wrong place to go. If we're trying to talk about philosophy, if we're trying to set something up that's more of an idea for the help of our fire chief and our police chief and our Gina and our Bola and the staff, and trying to provide some predictability to the fine people that work for this city, it seems to me that our discussion with regard to this concept in particular should be more about philosophically whether or not we believe in the notion of it, not necessarily based on its application to the city of Brentwood as it sits right now. Because I think we've all had anecdotal examples of where we think pay is skewed, either low or high. Mm-hmm. I'm just not sure that's the place to jump off and have a conversation about philosophy.
Okay. I do have to say, first of all, that the consultant and staff's first recommendation were that we pay the higher of the highest market or Brentwood's highest, not Brentwood's highest pay to date, but projected high. So there was a step plan in place, and if the employees thought they were going to get $100,000, we were going to go ahead and give them $100,000 because that was for morale purposes. And the whole study was presented to us based on that, and I would like to know how a consultant and or staff could make a recommendation to pay even further over the market when you're top of market.
I don't see that in their recommendations. Can you point that out in her study?
It was actually at the meeting that she corrected me in saying that it never had changed, but with you being newer, did you read her materials?
I did.
Okay.
And I also read the recommendations born out of that October 30th material. And I don't see contained within those recommendations any recommendation to pay based on expectation beyond the range of what we set. What I saw were recommendations that said we should develop a pay philosophy that describes what goal we want to get to. And if we have folks who are being paid in excess of that goal, that their pay... Linda's recommendation was that their pay be stopped temporarily in terms of base pay, but that they be eligible for non-base building merits, bonuses, if you will, that would not add to their base pay, but would still provide the incentive you're talking about. I didn't hear her recommend at the first workshop. Maybe I just missed it, but I didn't hear at the first workshop her actually recommend that we continue to grow the base of employees who are already beyond the 75th percentile, or whatever the number is. I mean, she didn't say 75th percentile. That was an example that she gave. She said, you know, you can pay at the top end, you could pay at 50%. She gave the example of, I think, Kirkwood, saying that Kirkwood was going to a 50% because of budget constraints and whatever other issues Kirkwood's got going on. But she said, once you've established what your philosophy is in terms of where you want to be on that spectrum as it relates to the other communities in the area, I don't remember her making a recommendation to say that based on expectation, we should still build base salaries beyond that expectation for purposes of morale.
What I was talking about was the study that was presented to us in November of 2014 at Ways and Means, and
right.
Then later proposed to us with a step plan.
Right.
And the key there is, and that was what was very confusing, because the way it was presented to us in Ways and Means was a little bit different than the way it was presented to us at the Board of Aldermen, and it was very, very confusing, and so she reiterated that at the last meeting. And
at the workshop meeting.
At the workshop, but I don't think what you understand, because we kept trying to get that nailed down, is it was the hire of Market Max or Brentwood's proposed max, which was the 30-step plan that we gave, that grade, that top of step. And then what she did, and I don't believe this was provided, but that was part of the original study, what I just handed you, those were the step plan steps that were modeled for the recommendation, which was to remain at, actually to go above market rate for morale reasons. And when I said I thought it changed, because I thought it was presented a little different at Ways and Means versus the Board of Aldermen, she went back and said that she had always made that contention. So I misunderstood it, I guess, at Ways and Means, but the contention was to pay at the higher of the market maximum or Brentwood's highest maximum. And it was based off of that 30-step or whatever step plan. And whatever grade they were on at the end of that grade is what they modeled in for the top pay and worked back. So for grade 19, let's see, you know, they used these different grades and then they modeled in and then worked backwards from it. And then as you can see, what was proposed to us, I have to be careful as to what was given in closed session and what was given to us in open session. But I can definitely confirm that, and I think Alderman Kramer can confirm the same fact that that is what originally the proposal was. And I find that proposal as a recommendation from staff and or the consultant to be alarming, and not certain why you would pay a consultant that would recommend to pay over the market rate. But
we've gotten past that now. We're up to the week.
Right. Well, we've gotten past that.
Right.
But again, the same with internal equity. You can't at face value say that's what the consultant recommended, because the first time around.
No, I'm not saying adopt it because the consultant recommended it, but we can have a conversation, a philosophical
right.
conversation about the concept of internal equity without having to first apply it to our employees to decide whether it's a good idea or not.
Okay. And the reason the thing is, without internal equity, the market places them both at the same grade. So I don't understand why we feel the need, when we had 8 matches for some of these positions, some of them 10 and 11, not, you know, any position in particular, why all of a sudden we need to break different positions, separate them differently when we're going to set our pay plan. I understand internal equity for the 6 positions, such as the sanitation supervisor and that. Those are positions that other cities don't have because they don't do their own trash. But I don't understand why it's necessary in some of these other positions. And another one would be accounting clerk. The market has it at 9, and we would move it to an 11 grade. And the comment with that particular position was most cities have accountants, not accounting clerks.
Yeah, and I had a problem with the internal equity process. This is just my opinion. And what I gleaned from the conversation at the first workshop was that the internal equity process was difficult for her as she applied it to Brentwood, because a number of times classifications of employment didn't exist in comparator cities. And therefore she was having to sort of break out pieces of jobs, put jobs back together, assemble them in such a way that they would somehow mimic or come close to mimicking other communities, and then apply the equity concept. To me, I thought that applying the internal equity process in a situation where so many of our job classifications didn't fit that comparator model, that was just problematic from the get-go. That was my take on it at the time.
But the original study listed each of the positions and how many matches we had, because if they didn't have 3 matches,
right.
they were thrown out. And these positions all had 8 or better. I mean, a lot of these, not, I didn't put the sanitation ones, the ones that weren't, there. You know, we have to basically say what the value is for that position, and if the employees are happy with it and keep coming back, I guess we set it right. I mean, because other than looking at, you know, Midwest waste, you know, right. You know, there's no other municipality around here that we can look at for those numbers. But for these other positions, we had adequate matches, and that was on exhibit. It was exhibit D from the original study, and it would look like this in your packet. If you had it with the original study.
What page is it on?
Well, mine is all broken up from the old study. I'm sorry, I don't.
So it's this one here?
Yes, and you'll see there that the number of comparator matching roles, mm-hmm. that's what we use to know whether or not, okay, you've got enough of a match to sync up.
Right.
And then from there, so it seems to me that the numbers, you know, we seem where the market's placing them is pretty consistent with market pay.
I just kind of feel like we're getting down into the weeds here.
Right. I just wanted to show that.
I was hoping we were going to kind of pick up where we left off.
Well, and that was the only thing is on this here, and I think it was a good point. We have to make a decision, no internal equity or internal equity.
I don't know about, I'm not sure the goal of this is to necessarily make a decision, but maybe to come to some understanding, or at least understand where we disagree or where we might find differences.
Yeah.
I'm not sure we're going to produce an agreement out of this.
Right. I mean, if we can work towards consensus, but if we can't,
absolutely.
Then we move on to the next topic, and I'm
sure.
Fine with that. But does anyone else have any questions regarding internal equity?
When we were at the last, keep going backwards in time, just to recap what we talked about before, the internal equity definition, a series of positions looked at differently by each municipality, trying to provide equity between those, for example, if we have a chief of police or a fire chief who are making different pay scale, how to bring those in line, looking at the scope of their duties, their skill set, and the contents of their job description. What do you think about that?
I gotta be honest. I this is one of those examples where I know it's not anybody's fault, but I would really, really like to hear, and I know we heard a little bit of it the first night, but I'd love to hear Gina weigh in on this a little bit, and I'd love to hear Justin and Bola to a certain extent weigh in on this as well. They did a little bit at the first meeting.
What about the philosophy of parity?
Right. I keep coming back to the concept that instances where the titles are the same, it seemed to me that the job descriptions were different enough that finding that
equilibrium
between them is
a challenge.
Absolutely a challenge.
But philosophically, if there was an equilibrium, ideally they would both be
right
on par.
I agree with that. I agree with that conceptually.
So what we talked about before was this 75%. We seem to agree upon the percentile of, one of the things that, I don't know if the mayor brought this up, maybe it was Linda that brought this up. She said that we need to make sure when you arrive at the consensus that we did, and that in terms of the philosophy, that you have no remorse or guilty feelings within your community about that position that you've taken. Is that a reflection of a philosophy that's broad in scale throughout the community, or is that biased in any way? And I felt like we all agreed that the 75% was not biased, and it was reflective of the message that we seem to have been given from not only the studies that have been done, but also the feedback we've gotten from the residents, that we are a community that is extremely fortunate with our resources, but that in contrast to maybe previously spoken belief in a previous administration, just because we have it doesn't mean that it's prudent for us to be spending it. And so what we didn't talk about with Linda was how to go about assuring the parity between two positions when, as you mentioned, David, there is this disparity between the job description, the risk profile, the skill set, so many things that go into that. And I do not remember if she commented on that topic.
I don't either.
Does that ring a bell, Maureen?
Well, I guess the question here is, we agreed on the 75th percentile. That's over. And whether you decide internal equity versus not, the biggest place we're seeing this is in the public safety. I mean, as far as the biggest impact on the dollars, except for that some individuals are taken down compared to the market quite a bit, so they'll be frozen, do you know what I mean? And the market values them more than we do. So, you know, then you're saying, okay, because the market values those positions differently, you know what I mean? Should we bring them to the market or should we drop them? And so we're not being consistent, I don't think, necessarily, in how we're determining. But again, the information that Linda had provided said that 4 pay more, 2 pay the same, 2 pay less. So it seems to me that there's not that big of a difference between, though there's a grade or so difference. And as we discussed at the last meeting, and I think Alderman Slusser had brought it out, as we'd said we were going to go with the market, but that we're not completely robots and we don't have to do everything strictly down the line.
Right.
And so if it's only a grade, and I think we've all made some acknowledgement that police positions become more and more difficult every year just because of all of the added, you know, requirements. Well, now they're all going to be CLIA certified, which I'm happy about, but there's just all of this adversarial nature to their job and all of the decision making that you have to make, and they, in this small community, they often assist fire and, you know, setting up the scene. I know they did a lot of clearing in the one hazmat thing, and so they work pretty closely together. And I had said that I would like to see the market begin to value police more, because I do think that their jobs have just, especially in the last few years, really have just become such a stressful position, and so many judgment calls you have to make it split moment, and the dangerousness of it just with the devaluation of life. So if we decide that we want to use pay parity because we want to make the statement of within one grade we value them just as much as we do our fire, I have no problem with doing that.
I think to the extent that you can, come to grips with some sort of an assurance on the congruity with that parity, I'm in favor of that. The philosophy I'm in favor of as well. You know, there are other things that go along with that. As you know, in our municipality, we have no control over this particular topic, but you know, there's a morale issue that goes along with that, that comes from perhaps department heads or from leaders past and present. Money is just one aspect of it, but I was really hopeful that tonight, barring any earth-shattering equation that we can come to regarding internal versus the no internal equity question, the stopping point that we had at the last meeting was about the ranges versus the step plans,
yep.
Commissioned versus the non-commissioned.
Right.
And I am here to announce that I have changed a little bit since our last meeting. As some may recall, I was reluctantly willing to go along with the possibility of a step plan for our commissioned employees versus non-commissioned, and that the non-commissioned would be encumbered by the market range principle and philosophy. Since that time, I have done some further research and some soul searching on that topic, and I think for the same reasons that I was looking forward to the market ranges for the non-commissioned employees, I feel a lot more comfortable, certainly my representation, if the whole city was the same. I think it's possible for us to award the merit, whether we're using non-base building incentives or whether we're using the incentives that come from the evaluations, still with the market ranges as opposed to the step plans. And here's why. The same argument that I mentioned last time, there is a sense that when you have a step plan, that it's almost a predetermined or preset arrangement of milestones that are predicted to be reached almost in a set pattern, to the point where there is less and less of an incentive to perform to the absolute top of the range, versus the market ranges and the review principles that go along with those. And once again, if Linda was here, I would probe her brain on this a little bit. The market ranges and the principles that go along with those, I think, is a lot more incentive, responsible, in terms of the productivity that you get from each employee. And I respect other opinions that may differ from that, but I just want to mention that I did change, and I'm a lot more in favor of market ranges for both the commissioned and non-commissioned employees.
Yeah, Tom, building on that, I had a comment, or I had a thought about that since the first workshop, and that was going to ask Linda a similar question along those lines, because it seems to me that the biggest problem we're going to have in implementing any kind of a philosophy that that is sustainable, given the economics of Brentwood and just how much money we're spending on salaries to begin with, what percentage of our budget it takes up, that I wondered if it would make some sense in the early stages of implementation to move ourselves to a market range type system to allow a greater amount of flexibility, mm-hmm. as we try to bring some of these disparate groups into line.
That's right.
Or alignment, I guess, if you want to say it that way. Because we have folks being compensated all over the place. Mm-hmm. I mean, we have folks at the very top end, and we have folks that are, I think, underpaid, and they're in the same groups and categories, and it seems to me that a step plan, and I kind of feel the same way you do. I mean, I was more along the lines of wanting to adopt a step plan for everything at that first meeting,
right,
to lend some predictability and to provide, I guess predictability was the greatest thing. But I've been thinking a lot more about it, and at least in the early stages of trying to implement a philosophy that actually tries to take into consideration all of what we're trying to do here, it seems to me that the plan that might allow for a greater amount of flexibility on the part of our staff who have to mete out these increases in salary might be to provide them a market range plan and provide them a greater amount of flexibility, at least in the early part of, as we're trying to figure out how this is all going to fit together.
And to that, if I could just respond real quick, Maureen, is, mm-hmm. and to nope. that end, one of the things that I reviewed was our past use of this 3% compensation, I guess, increase on a review basis per year as a function of the review process. That 1, 2, and 3%, the Ways and Means Committee was regularly recommending up to 3%, and at the end of the year, we'd always come back with 80, 90% of the people got the 3%. And I thought to myself, wait a second, we said up to 3%. How did everybody get 3%? And so we talked about the philosophy of the review process, and maybe some of those threes should have earned a five. And maybe some of those threes really were twos, but there's not enough flexibility there. Right. And so using your term flexibility, if there's a way that we can work with a staff, or perhaps Ann Linda, to come up with a more equitable way to incentivize and compensate our employees instead of the current fixed 3%, which I don't think has been working very well.
So would that take away any flexibility from department heads to award staff? And I'm looking at non-commissioned people, mm-hmm. say someone in public works.
Sure.
So you have a set schedule, and the head of the department just follows that schedule, or is there some flexibility in that range to award for merit or innovation? Or
I think if you have the range within to work, and it's possible for someone to reach the top of that range, and there's possible for someone to be frozen, in which case we'd have to talk about that non-base building topic.
Right.
But within that range, I think there should be some flexibility. And I think there should be more responsibility as well. Maureen may or may not remember past Ways and Means Committee meetings where we've kind of tried to talk about what was allowed to be talked about in open session in terms of personnel matters. What was the average, or what was the overriding set of criteria that were most often hit or missed? And we never really were able to get into that topic. And I think that we should, there should be less blinders on regarding that, and more knowledge amongst the aldermen about that process. And maybe Ms. Higby and or staff and the board can come up with some changes to that if we go in line, as you mentioned, with the market range versus the step plan philosophy.
Okay, that was the third talking point, and I'm fine with that. I'm fine to move on to that. The only thing is I want to know, as far as internal equity and no internal equity, how do we want to leave that? Are there questions that we want answered, or how do you want to leave that particular issue? That's all I'm really asking.
I still want more conversation with Linda. I want to have a conversation with her about the internal equity, no internal equity concept, because I'll admit, I was operating under a misapprehension for about half of that workshop that I thought I knew what the concept was. And then she said something that I said, well, wait a minute, that can't be right because I'm thinking it's this. And she said, no, you're wrong. This is what it actually is. And that, it was 2 hours in before I figured that out. And that's my fault, but I would like to have more of a conversation with her about that.
And then
there seems to be an interest in parity, but what the formula is to achieve that in terms of internal versus...
Well, I mean, again, internal equity is more about that separation of, not necessarily that they both may not be priced at grade 18, but the job responsibilities. Like, again, the biggest question was, does the market value this position more than that position? That's really what the question came down.
I thought the question was whether Brentwood valued it more.
Well, or is Brentwood's position different from the market that it needs to be valued more? Not whether Brentwood in itself, because then you are talking about strictly philosophical. If we, you know what I mean, if it was as simple as saying we think this position is more important than that position, do you know what I mean?
Yes.
I think that would be easy for us all to answer one way or the other. That's not what internal equity is, as far as it's, does the market value a position more than another position? And does Brentwood want to reflect the market, you know, in that separation? Or and at the very end of the conversation, the one question about the one position was, well, this position has a lot more responsibilities than others in the market, but her original data doesn't match that out. You know, when you looked at in the CD or the little disk flash drive she gave you, you can look at the job description, so forth. But there is that one which says, you know, how many comparator matches. And if they're a match, you know what I mean? It doesn't seem like we have that much disparity, but we can just ask her, we want to take in the note, we want to learn a little bit more about internal equity and how it works with the market versus Brentwood, and we also want to take into account if we want pay parity, what does that look like? And just leave that for her.
Yes.
Okay, and then moving on to the next step plan versus market ranges, I too had additional time to think about that, and I am still under the impression step plan for public safety, and the reason being is, again, because Ladue, Maplewood, Kirkwood, Webster Groves, Clayton, Richmond Heights, Hazelwood, Olivet, Frontenac, University City all do step plans for their public safety. And so I feel like if that's the market, and in the past we've been told by Chief Jury that we're going to lose employees to other cities that have step plans. And again, you can always say go in another city, but I kind of am a believer, especially in these positions, which, I mean, we may have additional, you know, responsibilities, I don't want to say, but for the most part, the basic premise of their jobs are pretty similar across the market because they also do a lot of mutual aid. They have to be able to communicate, same roles, same functions. So, you know, that was my thinking was, it's not so much necessarily what I like, it's when you're looking at a market study, what does this market do? And in this instance, the market favors step plans. So I still favor step plans, and I still, the logic behind it that someone in these positions could get injured sooner in their career, not, you know, hopefully it doesn't happen, but the fact that they can, that's a potential risk they take, then to get them up to top pay, you know, as soon as possible, and then hopefully they have a long career, but two, the same risk going into a building, the same risk coming up on a traffic stop or whatever, it's the same for both employees, whether they've been here 15 years or 7 years. I still support the step plan for commission.
But not for non.
And then if we decide, you know, we want to do merit, non-base building merit, so still have the capability of rewarding them when they do have had a great year, I still support that. I did kind of like the notion when Linda had mentioned at the last meeting is like, let's say we give a department, you know, you get 50,000 and you can, 100,000, whatever, and you can distribute as you see fit. I mean, I wouldn't mind exploring that because I know, I mean, I guess anyone that's managed individuals, you know, you've got your top key employees you do not want going anywhere. You use them to train other employees. You want to keep them, and they might deserve a little bit more of that nudge. And then there's others that, you know, are happy to make their salary. They want to do what they're told, and they want to go home at the end of the day, and that's a good, solid employee, and there's
punch
nothing
in,
wrong
punch
with
out.
That. So.
You're talking about, like, as a bonus?
Yes,
50,000?
Well, so it's like a bonus. You know, maybe instead of us saying up to 3% or up to, give more discretion to the supervisor because, like, you know, for instance, for me, I mean, you know, I think the supervisors want their departments to run smoothly. I mean, it reflects better on them. They look better if their employees are top caliber and, you know, and then there should be some incentive that if their departments are running well and efficiently and there's few errors and what have you, you know, then there's potential for a bonus for that individual too. I just think that there is motivation. Now, since we also met, though, I was at the end of the meeting leaning towards step plan for non-commissioned employees, and I have since changed my mind on that. The reason I kind of switched towards the step plan was Linda Higby was talking about it, and she said, in this market, with all the 3% raises, you know, generally, that the step plan, the market min average, all of it has both been kind of behaving like a step plan because there's only this small wiggle room of a raise, and so you really can't do much with it. And so I'm like, oh yeah, they really are almost, you know, 3%. You move up a step, there's not a whole lot of wiggle room with it. But my hope is that the economy is going to continue to improve, and then maybe there's more than 3% to throw around. And then when that happens, then you have more play with that amount and who deserves the 5% and who deserves less than that. So for the non-commission, I do support the minimum, maximum, and there was one other statement since then that I heard, and it was by Alderman Lockmuller, and I'll let you speak to it, but that these positions are more where you can have somebody be a star or, you know, more that they can bring forward an idea because, like I said, the other positions are a little bit more regimented.
Yeah, that's exactly. I think with commission, I mean, they're almost like military rank where they've got, they're used to their falling into this step and they've got their ranks. But as far as non-commissioned, say a guy on public works or someone that's you want to instill more innovation into, or maybe finds a way to process that saves the city money or helps get more work out of an individual, I think there's more incentive through a non-step plan for those type of workers. And when I looked at the study, out of the 14 cities, only 5 had step plans for non-commission employees.
Right.
So I'm just thinking there's more play for more innovation in those type of an employee.
Out of the 14, how many were the step for commissioned employees?
Almost all.
When we were,
for commission, was all
the problem is some of them don't have fire departments. They have fire districts.
Yeah, but everyone that had commissioned employees.
Right, they all had step plans. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
For commission?
8, 9, 10.
Yep.
10 of them, 10 had step plans.
Yeah.
For public safety. 8. And at the end of the meeting, I thought we were in pretty much consensus for the steps for public safety or commissioned employees. And we were not in consensus and needed to talk more because it was the end of the night. We were deciding whether we should have another meeting. We weren't in consensus regarding non-commission. Now, are we switching public safety? Is that what I'm hearing?
No, it's not. It's not that. And my change of heart here, to whatever extent it is a change of heart, has to do with what I see as being a difficult implementation process. If there are some hard truths in all of this, it seems to me that there are people who have been highly valued as employees of the city of Brentwood who are going to see their salaries stopped for a period of time. And I just think for me to sit here and say, well, that's a difficult thing to talk about, that's pretty patronizing of me to say I'm not the one having to raise a family on the same money now for the next 5 years. And I had thought about this a lot. If this is something we're going to do, if this is the road we're going to travel down, because it's the sustainable thing to do, and perhaps it is, but it seems to me that we ought to be mindful in the implementation process of trying to figure out ways in which we can maximize the amount of flexibility with which we can implement this and minimize the amount of financial hardship on people who are at the highest ends of this pay, and they're there for a reason. It's not like mm-hmm. they just fell into this job and are making $80,000 and $90,000 a year. These are people who are talented and we value. It's a difficult conversation. And so my only thought about the change of heart that I'm talking about is a temporary one. As the process gets fitted into place and as time goes on, I agree with the concept that the step plan provides far more predictability. And to Chief Jury's point that he's made previously about retention is an issue when you don't have a predictable plan like that in place or something like it. I understand all that. And so my change of heart has more to do with the initial years of this than it does anything else.
Well, initially when this came forward to the board, I was, for good employees, was okay if we stayed at top of market. You know, I had always said I don't favor cutting whatsoever. But to my surprise, Alderman Slusser and Alderman Toohey were pretty strong about the 75th percentile.
I agree.
And everyone seemed to be following their lead.
I'm not changing my opinion about that. I'm not
Right.
What I'm saying is, it's a difficult thing, and the reality of that is that, I've been searching since the workshop for a way to articulate this better than I have, but it's a hard thing. It's a very hard thing.
Maureen, I just wanted to say real quick, since you mentioned it, for myself, I was not following Alderman Toohey's or Alderman Slusser's methodology or thought process in regard to the 75 percentile topic. I was always thinking, and going back to the previous administration, had been on record with difficulty in overpaying for employees just because we could. I know that we have a valuable place to work. We also value our employees. We have wonderful benefits. We have a risk profile that I think is very attractive to some members of other communities who would love to work in Brentwood. And those who do work here, I know they're very appreciative. But I do have a problem with looking at other municipalities that are comparators of our city and seeing that in some cases we are beyond what some would even call luxurious. And that's difficult from a fiduciary point of view. So the 75 percentile topic came from Linda Higbee. I think even the mayor said to Linda, if this was your city, what would you do? How would you arrive at a proposed philosophy?
Right.
And I think she was the one that suggested, if it was my city, absolutely, based upon the information that I'm aware of and the work that I've done, a 75 percentile rooted philosophy is one that I think anyone should be able to go out on the street and face their neighbors and say that they're okay with that and they think that that's fair.
Well, and part of that was too, though, she was also at that time the quality of work, and she didn't feel that the quality of work warranted greater than that. Now, hopefully, you know, we're changing all of that over. Did I say something wrong, David, or was it?
I didn't get that from her, that
yeah.
she made some
the question
comment about
was,
the quality
and it
of
was,
work.
Chris that had said to me, you know, I'd asked, you know, he said, you know, that Linda had recommended 75th percentile, and she said especially since your employees are not even, you know, not better than average. She didn't even think they were average. So that was said at the last meeting, and that was her comment. And there's supposed to have been done an efficiency study, which was supposed to have been completed, but I asked the mayor about that, and he said, to what point, since the employees aren't considered average, that, you know, that's just a waste of money. But now we're going down where, I mean, I know it's difficult to freeze pay. I mean, you know, I agree that you don't want to cut pay and the fact that people have built their household incomes, and you don't want to turn around and do that. But these decisions are difficult. I mean, when I first got on, I had to face the employee manual and then immediately go right into the budget and talk about a topic that nobody wanted to pass or nobody really wanted to look at. I mean, they didn't want to know or didn't want the residents to know where we fell in the market and what we were paying, and that, you know, people were lining up to take jobs here. And, you know, that's all said and good, and it's fine if we decide, you know, where we want to pay on the market, if we decide we want to be at the top end. But as the mayor has said, he has to have a reason, he has to have a rationale, he has to have a pay philosophy, and he has to be able to explain it to the residents. And that's what we have to do. And, you know, unfortunately, we had to come in, and something that I think for me personally is fundamental business to look at the market wasn't done over these years. And so then we have to come in and, you know, play the heavy, and it's no fun. You don't get to be Santa Claus. You have to start making strategic business decisions, and you have to do it right in front of the employees, which in private, you don't have to do that. You have the luxury of negotiating. Not that you still negotiate in good faith, and you want what's best for the employees as well as you want to be fiscally responsible. But when it's your own money, you can do whatever you want. But when it's other people's money, you have to be a little bit more diligent. And again, at the end of the day, we just have to be able to say, we went into this with our eyes wide open. Now this time we have the data, so we know what we're approving, and we want to, like we said, we want a philosophy that aldermen to come and mayors to come can continue to build on and be able to really budget and manage their city finances coming out too, though, in the future. So I don't know. I think now all of a sudden, I know, like you said, it's difficult, but I think anything we do, I mean, it's going to be difficult unless we just say, let's keep going the way we were. And I can't get on board for that because now we have the data facing us. Now the question is, if we reconsidering 75th percentile versus top of market, that's a different thing. But again, it's going to require freezing salaries regardless wherever we go. You know, one's going to freeze them longer, one's going to freeze them shorter.
Right.
And we have to decide where they'll be. But if that is, I mean, but if we decide to go to that, then I'm expecting white glove service. I mean, white glove service, because if you want to be the top of the market, then you've got to be able to brag about all of your employees. And if that's what we want, that's great. But
I don't think anybody's expressed that I've heard tonight anything other than 75th percentile. And I haven't expressed a different opinion either.
Okay, I guess I just don't understand why, when you say that, I mean, regardless of where in the market, the salaries are going to be frozen, a good portion of them.
Well, and that was the premise of my concern, was that we were going to be freezing a number of salaries. And my concern is that, what do you do in the face of that in terms of giving people who you have valued by paying them a fair amount of money to do good jobs for the city of Brentwood? How do you tell them that you still value their work in ways other than building the base of their salary, at least in the initial years when it's frozen? That's my dilemma.
Is the dilemma, though, are you trying to find non-monetary ways to show them you value?
No, but the use of non-base building incentives, the use of
we other... agreed for non-base building last meeting.
Yeah, no, I know we did. And I also just thought that the market ranges, I don't know. This is another time where I think I'd really benefit from being able to bounce some information ideas off of Linda. But when faced with this kind of a situation where you find yourself wanting to implement a system that will essentially freeze out certain employees for a period of time in terms of rate increase, in terms of pay increase, if she had any suggestions on how something like that might be implemented, rather than just coming down in 1 year and saying, this is where you're going to be, and this is where you're going to be until the market catches up.
David, if I could just introduce a nuance, if I could, to that thought process, and that is, somebody, a resident, for example, could say, I understand the desire to still want to award incentive, whether it's base building, non-base building, whatever, to make sure the employees, from a salary point of view, feel valued despite what they may have received from their department heads on a morale basis to feel appreciated.
Right. And you spoke a little bit about this at the first workshop, too.
I did. And I really do think that the city could do a much better job in that regard. It goes a long way. There are many, many employees who feel that their only way to feel appreciated inside, since they're not being told that they're appreciated, they're not being awarded that they're appreciated, they're not being recognized on a regular basis in various forms, is the check. I got a great big check. I can go home and I can show everybody I got this check. That is my appreciation. Instead of going home on a regular basis, feeling appreciated, and you know what, if we get a little bit more money, that's great. As long as we're making about the same as everybody else, I'm okay. I'm happy with my job. I feel appreciated. There's a psychology about that that I think has gone on unrecognized. Now, we are a city, we're not a private company, So maybe we don't look at things the same way, but I have seen private companies achieve enormous productivity successes without having to rely upon just an increase of a percentage on checks through this rewarding the employees and making them feel appreciated, letting them know that they're appreciated. But one thing I wanted to finish is to go back to that capped out employee, whether it's a salary cap or whether it's a frozen employee, that employee, a resident could say, got to that point because they were maybe paid over scale up to that date. And maybe, I mean, we don't want to feel sorry for them. Maybe they've been overpaid all that time, or maybe they've been paid above market all that time, or in the case of some friends that I have who have a true salary cap at their position, they feel comfortable knowing that they're a star. They have capped out. They're making the maximum they can make in their company, that the company allows for that position, and they've been doing so for a few years, and they don't feel unrewarded because they've maxed out. And they're not asking for, I guess in the case of one friend I know, he's not asking for extra compensation because he feels appreciated. He feels fulfilled in his job. It's a term you see a lot more in private business than you do at a city, maybe. But I just wanted to address the need or the perceived need to have to compensate that frozen employee for the fact that he cannot go any higher until he catches up. And I just want to remind the process that there could be some residents who would rightfully be able to say, well, yes, that employee is frozen now, but that employee has also been receiving what many can apparently now say has been receiving an above market wage for some period of time.
Mm-hmm. Can I, and with regard to that, I mean, you do at some point we are just going to have to bite the bullet, and it will be. And I do agree, though, with what Alderman Kramer said. You can say that some positions have been overpaid, and as a result of that, though, their overtime is over. They're sick because it's accrued on hourly rate. I mean, it's all feeds benefits into this. And when I was talking with the mayor, I had said, you know, you can explain too that, you know, it is unfortunate that in the past there was not a business rationale for paying for the pay philosophy. There was no study, there was no comparison, even though this has been done in other cities for quite a while. And, you know, it's unfortunate that the predecessors, you know, led them to believe that these are the kinds of salaries that are commanded in these positions, and they were, you know, not informed correctly. And therefore, you know, now we have to do the task of, you know, freezing it. But again, it's better to be frozen at a over market than, I mean, even for a while until even 75th percentile, they'll be up there. But and the other thing too is that later we're going to get into benefits. And I think that's like where you're saying, you know, you can't just bite off all of it at one time. You can't just, you know what I mean? This is what the market does. We're not going to get that. You're not going to get that. You can't, you know what I mean? We have to tackle one thing and then start looking at the other things. And depending on future revenue projections, so forth, you know, take our time in looking at other things that if money is needed, maybe this is where we go to, but knowing that they're still maybe getting some other things that the market's not providing. So I don't know if that helps you a little bit with that.
No, I'm sorry.
I didn't know if that helps a little bit with
that. Yeah, except that I saw this tonight, and I don't know. I'm perfectly fine with talking about the concept of benefits and the philosophy of benefit packages. I don't know that in a meeting like this, in a workshop like this, where we're missing three aldermen, that we ought to be necessarily down in the weeds, to kind of steal Steve's word a little while ago, with regard to specific issues of short-term disability and things like that. I'm comfortable talking about the philosophy of benefits and And actually, the notion that this was something I was thinking about in addition was that as we bring these things into line, that we perhaps stagger how they're brought into line, as a way to perhaps soften the blow of what we're doing in other areas.
I completely agree. The only reason I put this, it was not to discuss each of these items. It was, these were the general topics that were covered in the compensation study, i.e. not number five, I don't think.
Right.
I'm not certain that was. And so it wasn't really to go into each of those. They were just talked, you know, hit. There was a survey done on them. And again, like I said, we can't get into all of this, and it's difficult enough to convene and get us together and to just discuss, as we've gotten to, just the pay philosophy and the step versus non-commissioned. And, you know, it's a step in the right direction. Do you know what I mean? And then the others can be pulled out in a more meaningful way and tackled, you know. And again, they don't necessarily need to go away. We just need to see, you know, be attuned that if revenue starts to dip, or if that when we're giving them, that they're known that this isn't for perpetuity. You know what I mean? This is as appropriated. And, you know, hopefully we'll continue to do great, and Brentwood Boulevard will have some meaningful redevelopment, and Manchester, and, you know, revenues will come, but we can't sustain that. And also, too, though, just based now that we do have data, we have to have some semblance of the market when we're making these decisions.
I kind of agree with what you were saying, David, because, and I'm new to this, but the employees didn't steal this money. The board approved it.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
True. So somewhere along the line, somebody before us approved this, and now it all of a sudden changed the plan. I can see for new guys coming in or guys partway through, and, you know, if you want better pay, then you better yourself and move up a rank. Mm-hmm. But I think, you know, guys towards the end, maybe through a bonusing process or something, mm-hmm. maybe, I don't know, we keep them.
Right.
Changing the plan right in the middle of everything.
Right.
Guys that get froze out.
And I think we all agreed that we were the non-base building, so that we're not continuing to inflate, you know, other benefits. And really, maybe the conversation should be with Linda, you know what I mean, Linda and Bola, but also the supervisors to know, do you know what I mean, these guys, I mean, you know, they know who their stars are and that, and, you know, what would incentivize them? You know, and it may be, you know, naturally money is always a good thing, but there could be other things in addition to that, or a goal, even oriented thing. Do you know what I mean? Maybe there's a project that's been sitting around that we wanted to get done, but we can't, and it's gonna take a little bit of extra time or hours, you know, and maybe they're willing to say, hey, we wanted to do this and we're gonna do it, and if we meet that goal, then, you know, we're gonna reward them for it. Mm-hmm. So there's definitely, and so I don't think we've closed, I think that actually by the last meeting, from my understanding, is we were keeping that door open to do bonuses. But that just that they were non-base building.
Non-base building.
Right.
Which we were gonna get an acronym for that, but. So I guess the thing is, and I think we're all in agreement on that we still wanna be able to reward our capped employees. And I said that from the day one, that when you brought salary caps, because I wasn't as familiar with them in the private sector, but that if somebody goes above and beyond in a particular work year, it does not seem fair that they should not get any recognition. And especially too, what if you have a year where we do have, you know, another one of those really hazardous situations, and, you know, it takes a lot of time and then a lot of follow-up and to getting procedures to prevent it not happening or whatever entails, then they should be able to be rewarded. You're going to have atypical years.
Maureen, I'm just curious, go back in the topic of step versus non-step, and if you could separate out the conversation about what other municipalities are doing or what is currently being done in this municipality. Philosophy-wise, what do you see is the rewarding or non-rewarding philosophy behind having a step plan or non-step plan for the commissioned employees?
Well, I always this is the dilemma that's in my head, and maybe I don't know enough about the public safety, because I'm going to go there first, because the other one, I don't believe in the step plan. In my head, I think, okay, naturally, the employees that have been there longer have more experience, so those are going to be the ones that are going into the building, or they're the ones that are going to set up and do command, you know, as we all had to take that FEMA thing, and they're going to be coordinating that. And so years translates also into skill level and so forth. And so typically, you know, you want to reward them as they gain each additional skill. But what I'm understanding from hearing the fire chief, and maybe incorrectly, and the market, is that a lot of the skills are learned right away, and they all have, to some extent, all of them. And it always seems like one backup person can move into another position, especially after we did that command. Everybody kind of knows their role. And so they could all be put in harm's way. And so what? Who goes into the burning building? I think I read in the captain, fire captain, you have to go in. I think in the description, the job description I had was reading that Chief Jury had put together. But does the other, the guy that has only 2 years under his belt, also go into the building? And the same, especially with police, I think they all have to, you know, it's a different level and what you reward too. I mean, like, you know, sometimes I think the police officers on the street have it worse than the desk, you know, the officer that maybe is doing all the scheduling and everything, because one position seems more valuable to another. And so that's why I always kind of go back to market. I mean, even when you're doing ranges, you're looking at the market for the ranges. And so, you know, I know typically I have priced people out of the market relatively quickly to range max, because I could spot them as ideal employees and I didn't want them to leave. And so, you know, I may tell them, you're getting up to the top right now, you're not going to get these kind of raises, but I don't want you to walk out that door for another job. And so you bump them up top. But again, I just feel like in this particular, in public safety, that you kind of have to go by the market. And I know people may disagree with me on that, and, you know, and that's fine, but the information that I'm getting is that they all can take on the same amount of risk, even regardless of their years. And that's kind of the methodology for getting them to top pay. And another thing is that, in addition, at least for fire and that, but the mutual aid, they're on step plans. So your cohorts, your peers, even though they're not right in your fire department, they are your peers, they're your coworkers, because you're always working together on a project, and they're on step plans. And so I feel like that seems to me like a valid reason that we could lose a fireman or police officer early.
Tom, I interpreted your question as more about the differences between, philosophically, between a step plan implementation and a market plan. And to me, it seems like the step plan provides more predictability for everybody involved. You look at that plan, you look at that chart, and you know that if I'm up for the next step, this is going to be my salary. Whereas in the market ranges, there's a greater amount of flexibility, but there's also a greater amount of unpredictability on the part of whether or not I'm going to merit 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever the number is. And, you know, so
there's a difference.
Yeah, and I, right.
There's a difference, and I guess what I was trying to probe with Maureen was, yes, with the step plan, it's a traditional, commissioned, automatic, preset, almost a military arrangement that's been incorporated for a period of time. But what I ask myself philosophically is it our responsibility to compensate in that regard because it's traditional or because it's been
everyone else is doing it.
It's been regimented by other municipalities. And I'm up against, why am I using one philosophy for the non-commissioned, another philosophy for the commissioned, when what we're after as an employer is the very best productivity every single day with no guarantees. There is no guarantee. There's no guarantee you're going to have a job next week, next year, 2 years from now. There's no guarantee you're going to make this then, and that then, and that then. No, that's not, in my opinion, as an employer, that's not how it should be.
But I do think the level of risk is what plays into
That's where the base pay comes in. That base pay is to reward that risk level.
But there's nothing magical about the step. I mean,
step
if you make
for me
one
is,
at a time, please.
Sorry.
I guess again, I'm going to go back to the step pay plan, and it is regimented. It is used what's used in the industry. You know, I don't know whether all of these other municipalities just arbitrarily got in line and followed each other, but it is what's used in the industry, and it's pretty similar too, like you were saying, to the military. And there's oftentimes in the military where somebody doesn't go up to the next rank. They don't get the next step because they didn't. You know, they weren't able to keep up at boot camp or what have you, and they stay at that step. And then, you know, they either learn and get with the program or they're out of Brentwood and we get another good employee in that wants to move up that next step. So,
but what's the practical difference between somebody that we have a step plan that incorporates seven steps and so it's a 5% increase between steps or a 3% increase between steps and a market range that is 3%? So I'm being compensated on a market range and my supervisor gives me a 3% raise every year for the next 4 years, or I'm on a step plan and every year for the next 4 years I raise up four steps. What's the practical difference between the fact that I'm making the exact same money whether I was in a step plan or whether I was in a market plan?
Well, the difference is the minimum and maximum. With the ranges, you're not guaranteed what year you'll rise to the maximum.
You just explained that you're not guaranteed of moving up a step every year either.
No, but you know if you do the job and you perform correctly that you will get to top pay at this point in time. And the reason that they want them to top pay, from my understanding, is there's risk involved in their jobs. And therefore, they should be getting top salary because they're taking the same risk that a neighbor, their fellow firemen or policemen are taking, and so therefore they should be compensated the same. And in the unfortunate or unlikely event, but if they did get harmed, they get to retire at a salary that reflects the danger that they're willing to take on. And that's the difference for me, is it's getting them to the top pay at a quicker rate if you can perform the job. You know what I mean? You don't get to go up the step if you can't perform the job, but you definitely get there quicker, and the idea is to make sure that everyone is getting that top pay, because every time they go into a risky situation, they all are sharing the same risk. And that's my understanding of it, and I support it. And whereas range, minimum, maximum, you don't know how long that range is. I mean, some people may say, well, he's almost at the top, I'm going to eke out percent for a while. Do you know what I mean? You don't know. So there's no set time frame for the minimum maximum.
And wasn't that kind of what they're looking for in hiring?
Is my understanding. But if you want to say that all of, as Alderman Kramer was saying, that all of these other municipalities kind of arbitrarily picked this and there's no basis, but I do believe there was a basis, and I do believe that, like, again, though, for me, these are guys that they have mutual aid with, and that's what they're getting. The real question is the number of steps, but that's how I see the difference.
Also, the city's in a different position now than it was in the past. There were many times when we had Ways and Means Committee meetings, 2009 as an example. There are times when we had, the tips weren't paid off, the money wasn't flowing in, things were tight, and we were in a situation where I felt like there were certain amounts of pay and compensation that had to go out the door because it was expected and we kind of promised that. You know, we've heard about these internal kind of structures that were used in various departments. And that caused hardships. We had to go back and look and search through as best we could. And at certain times it was like being underwater with goggles, and you had water in your goggles. So we did the best that we could with the information that we were given. But we were forced to make decisions about cuts on certain things or things that we had to wait until later to take care of. You know, we had Chief Niemeyer for a long time was asking for new and better pieces of equipment to replace vastly outdated things, but we couldn't because we had to pay for all of these things that were promised. And if we didn't, boy, were we in trouble. So I think to the extent that we are in a different position now, so then the question is, what is our fiduciary responsibility? And how predictable are we responsible to be versus how predictable we could be? I think in that, in between those two topics is the question. And I still feel like we can adequately continue to compensate our commissioned and non-commissioned employees with this range, especially if we go back over the philosophy that's used with the parameters, the percentages, maybe it goes up to 5%, and the non-base building compensation added on to that. That's not quite so predictable, but it does reward performance. And it does maybe achieve a different standard for other cities to look to us instead of us cookie-cuttering something that's been done over and over again.
Well, we've set the mold for a long time.
I understand.
With what we've done.
I understand.
That is the point when you're looking at a market. And I mean, I wouldn't say that we're taking one outlier. I mean, it's a pretty prominent, you know. But anyway, I think we should, since we had some consensus on step plan for public safety at the last meeting, I guess we should all just decide, or not decide, just state where we're at this point in our thinking. Now, are we still favoring step plan for them, or have we changed our mind with that regard?
Well, without taking a vote, as the mayor
would remind us. Right, no vote. This is just consensus
just
building.
Kind of a
Do you know what I mean? So
yeah.
What it means, though, is if we've changed, then we have to, if we can get a workshop with the entire board here, we'll have to revisit that particular topic, which we thought, I thought was
maybe. I have
maybe
too.
I have changed.
I would tell you that I'm coming to the idea that for whatever reason, and I'm not necessarily interested in going back in time and trying to get at the root problem of how we got to where we have some, you know, junior officers in the fire department making more than people they report to in a couple of instances, and other things that are clearly out of alignment. But I'm changing my philosophy, my own personal feeling about how we get to where we bring things into alignment. And I am currently of a mindset that we ought to at least give some thought to incrementally bringing something into reality. We ought to, and I'm not even sure I know exactly what that necessarily would be, but it just seems to me that and that's why when I started thinking about the market range concept as opposed to the step plan concept and the conversation that we had at the last workshop, I like the flexibility of the market range when you've got people that are outside the outer limits of comparator cities. It doesn't really matter what concept you use. You're talking about freezing their salaries, at least for a period of time. If you're doing anything in a reasonable way with an eye towards a budget,
right,
you're talking about freezing certain salaries.
Right.
I'm struggling with an idea of trying to get to the goal of 75th percentile.
Implementation.
But I don't know how fast we get there. That's what I'm struggling with right now. And that's my only change. I'm not abandoning the concept of the 75th percentile. I agree philosophically with what Linda had said at the last meeting, that she would choose it for herself. I don't want to take issue with you, and I don't want to have an argument about it, but I don't remember her making a comment about the inadequacy of employees. But I do remember her talking about the 75th percentile as it pertains to just a market concept, the idea that if you're in the 75th percentile and somebody wants to go out and do better, they're going to be hard-pressed to find another job that isn't already taken that is paying more than the 75th percentile. That's what I remember her saying that night.
Well, she definitely said 75th percentile. The other comment was an additional comment, and Mayor Thornton can confirm that she had made a comment, some of that or not. It doesn't really matter.
Whatever.
To me,
that's not the point of what I'm saying. My point is that I'm not saying that, and I don't believe that,
right,
first of all. And second of all, I think the 75th percentile makes sense because of pure economic market analysis. And the idea that if you are being paid in the 75th percentile and you are seeking other employment, 75% of the jobs out there are going to be paying less than what you're making. and the 25% are going to be harder to come by because there's going to be people in those jobs and there's going to be competition for those jobs. And that, I'm comfortable with us being in that range. That's my philosophy.
My the problem I'm having, I mean, and I would love to see what you, if you could somehow put an example or writing what your implementation, what you're talking about, step plan versus range implementation.
As soon as I know it, I'll articulate it.
Okay, that which is fine. You can take your time. I'm not saying,
well,
but I'm
just
saying
don't.
Though that, you know, you can look at the ranges and see. But the other issue here is that the firemen and the fire chief, they brought the step plan to us, and they also have labor negotiations, and they've requested the step plan. So it's odd that now all of a sudden at this point we're going to totally change the notion of...
Well, Maureen, we're not totally changing. You asked each of us individually what our philosophy was at this point.
Oh, no,
I'm telling you honestly my philosophy. Just because I may have changed my thought a little bit about this doesn't mean we've collectively moved. I'm just telling you what I'm thinking about. I'm being honest and...
David, I'm not
and
trying to
frank about what I'm saying.
What I guess the difficulty I'm having is I don't understand what you're saying. Like,
and
I
that's fine.
Yeah,
but
I'm
don't
just
put a
that,
bigger impact on it than just me giving an. It's just me giving an opinion. I'm just telling you what I think. And if I could articulate it better, as I've already said, I would. I can't. You're asking me my feeling. My feeling is it's going to be hard for us to all at once implement any kind of a plan. And I am more comfortable with the idea that we might do this incrementally. How that's accomplished, I don't know yet.
Okay.
But we're not voting on anything tonight.
No, no. And in the discussion,
so I can't explain what I'm thinking to you beyond that. And I'm sorry, but I can't.
No, and I'm not. It doesn't matter to me where you fall on this particular conversation. And I'm really not certain that I know how we got where the conversation went, which is fine. You two seem to understand, and that I don't. But what I thought we were trying to decide was, or not decide, but discuss was, do we lean towards a step plan for public safety or market ranges? And are you telling me at this point in time you think you lead to market ranges?
I do, for an unconventional
okay.
reason.
Then
yes.
That shows a shift. From what we knew.
Not we, me.
No, no.
I don't think anybody else is agreeing with me. I don't know anybody else that expressed the notion of a market plan for commission personnel. I don't think anybody
has
said that but me.
Okay, I guess, and I guess when I'm saying we was, I'm kind of folding in from the last meeting when we had a consensus, but losing you, and
well,
then Tom makes it less of a consensus, so maybe I'm just saying it wrong, and it doesn't, but again, you have a shift to market ranges. I thought Tom said that he had shifted, so he shifted to market ranges.
Both, we're both different reasons, but we both got to the same
right.
place.
Right. So that was all I was trying to say.
Right.
So please, no. And all that means is that we need to have this conversation with all of the aldermen, or at least two more aldermen present. That's all it means. And so it needs to stay on the list.
Steve, have you even to
No, I haven't changed. I think it's still step plan for commission.
And non for non.
Cindy?
Step plan for commissioned. My thought is too, okay, as far as step plans go for commissioned employees, I look at it as it's not a range. It's a, you know, this is what your salary is now, and then in however many years, this is what your salary will be. You'll get bumped to that. It's not like a range. You won't get bumped to this box, which is from here to here.
In the middle, yeah.
So, that way they know what they're making as far as the step plan goes for commissioned employees. For non-commissioned employees, if we did not a step plan, but what you're saying is after a certain amount of, you know, time of being employed here, this is, you'll get bumped to the next level, which is within this range, between this amount, dollar amount, and this dollar amount, based on their performance. Is that kind of...
To some extent, yeah. I mean, my goal would be to put in the hands of the supervisors, the people meeting out the raises, some flexibility and some ability, some power to say, you don't warrant an increase, you warrant 1%, you warrant 5%.
You earned.
I Right, you earned 5%, and that, so that's, yeah, to your point, I think that's, yeah.
So my thought is, step plan for commission employees, where it's, this is, you make this much now, you'll make this much then, and then this much, and however many years, or however long you want to have the step plan, we decide, or whatever. For non-commissioned, a market range where you're looking at each box they move from, you know, if you're looking at, like, the way they have it down on, you know, formatted, there's a range.
Right.
Based on their...
And we select the range based on budget and based on... Right, exactly.
Yeah. And so then, based on the last workshop, as far as step plan for public safety, I agreed. Cindy agreed. I don't think you were decided yet, Steve, but you're for public safety.
Public safety.
And yeah. And so were Alderman Toohey and Alderman Slusser. And now you two, at this point...
Yeah, I think so. And I think Andy was the only one that... I think Andy was the only one that talked about a market plan, right? Mm-hmm. For everything.
For both.
Yeah.
Okay,
that's right.
So that's where
that's
we're at
right.
today.
Yeah.
So just
I mean, assuming Andy hasn't changed his mind.
Right,
and
we're just recapping. That's all it is.
I mean,
you
right.
know, that's why I was trying to say there was a shift. You
right.
know, it's not cut in stone. We can change it all the way up to the budget, and then even after that, in every year. So, and then now for market ranges for non-commission, I support them now. I was leaning towards the steps, as I said at the beginning, based on that 3%, but now I started non-commission, and then by the end of last meeting I was leaning towards step, and now I'm back to non-commission, just using the minimum range. And I think now Cindy supports that, and
Steve,
and then Tom.
We seem to all be
and you. So I think now that one, which might have gone to step plan after last meeting, could go the other way the next meeting
right.
with all of us. So it seems like there's more consensus to go with public safety step plan, non-commissioned, minimum maximum ranges.
Right.
Does that seem?
In terms of the majority versus the minority, yes.
Yeah, that's all we can hope
but,
for.
Yeah.
Right.
I think that some of that might even change a little bit once we have a chance to hear from Linda again and maybe Gina again.
I agree.
I mean, I think this is. You know, some may wonder, was it profitable for us to be here? I think it's profitable for us, for anyone to have a chance to talk. You know, this is the only way to do this legally is for us five to be on board with an open meeting. Otherwise, we can't have meet amongst ourselves.
That's right.
So I think it's profitable from that standpoint. However, it would have been even more profitable if we would have had Linda and or some of the others to bounce the ideas off of.
But I think we have a good starting point for asking
yes.
her the questions, because like me having difficulty understanding David and vice versa, we've kind of gotten through the weeds, we'll use yours again, so now we can get a little bit more to work, and some of the aldermen that like more efficient meetings too, if we get them on board next time, we'll be able to be a little bit more efficient with our time and a little bit more direct.
Well, I think it's helpful too, just because if you have too much time in between meetings, you kind of, unless you go over this stuff to remind yourself constantly of, it gives you better talking points and understanding once again, we kind of pull it all together.
It kind of goes a little bit stale if we have too much time in between these meetings.
Yes, I agree. It's like you're like, okay, I have to, let me get back into this mode again. And here we've kind of brought ourselves back into this mode. And
right.
I think that's
And here
helpful.
We know, though, between the two meetings, three of us have shifted our position on something. Do
yep.
you know what I mean?
Yep.
So
yep.
there's value in that. And then the other items, like I said, they were just things at some point in time. I don't think tonight that we need to address all of that. The one thing under the benefits, and if you guys don't want to talk about it, we can, but I had this conversation with Mayor Thornton when we were first doing it, is that having the benefits in the employee manual is unusual. I mean, typically benefits are, you know, when you're given the employee manual, it's all the rules, do's, don't do, you know, policies, that kind of thing. But benefits are usually a benefit package. And I think at some point we should remove the benefits from the employee manual, because benefits are just like salary, it's every year. Now, I'm not saying we need to change them or anything like that, but it's more appropriate for them not to be in the employee manual. again, the manual's more for policy and that kind of thing. That's just my opinion. Anyone's welcome.
Maureen, hopefully, maybe for all of us to think about it, if 8:30 was a potential pausing point or maybe even a finishing point, as 2 hours into it.
Oh, okay.
Can I quote you on something you mentioned in the past regarding benefits and see if you're still on the same page? You had mentioned in the past that you thought that the, and I'm not advocating this or against it, but I wanted to see if you were still advocating this, that the employees should be contributing more for the payment of the benefits versus the city.
When we were looking at benefits, we were looking, knowing that the employees were paid way over market, but we didn't know what amounts. And I always said I couldn't cut someone's pay or even discuss freezing someone's pay without a thorough study and something that was comparing apples to apples. So at the time we were doing the employee manual, the only one I had umbrance with was the short-term disability. And the reasoning I had it with there is, one, some cities don't offer it, and almost all cities, if they do offer it, the employees pay. The issue I had with it is the 120-day sick pay accrual, that was to serve as like a short-term disability bank, that if you built those up, and even at one point they allowed them to be shared.
Sure.
But if then you had this large bank. And I used to talk to Mayor Kelly, you know, this is not on the board, just going to board meetings. And I asked him about that. And he said, well, Maureen, we don't have short-term disability. That's why the large accrual. But once we get short-term disability, that 120-day accrual will go away. And it didn't go away. And so I don't think it's much. It's a very minuscule amount, but I thought for what all we were giving, paying over market, longevity pay at the time, attendance pay was in there, now that's gone. But considering everything that we were given, I thought just to ask, it would be the first time to actually, I guess, in a way cut, because we were going to be asking them to pay for short-term disability, was a reasonable request. Now, in light of having this information, as I said tonight, and you're looking at, you know, freezing pay, you know, we can't do it all at once, and it wouldn't be fair, because then you are going backwards, and we said that we wouldn't do that. So that was the one thing, and when I brought it up, I'll never forget when I brought it up at the employee manual thing, and there was a employee that came to the podium, and you would have thought asking them to pay for that, I was taken away half of their salary. So hopefully, like I said, we can't do everything at once, and maybe we won't have to again. Now we have a basis, now we have numbers, and now we can start also having revenue projections. And it's something that you look at every year, and you may say, you know what, we're doing really well, and we want to continue to reward our employees. But you know what you're doing. You're not just arbitrarily doing it and not know what the market's doing. But as I said, in light of this year, looking at freezing pay, then I think we should.
You're less inclined to advocate now.
Yeah, I definitely think that we need to phase it in. And like I said, it doesn't matter. We just have to decide where we want to be in the market. And assuming, our pay philosophy may be different than others. You could have another board come on and want to be top. You could have one that want to be lower. I mean, it's just a starting point. It's a point, though, that you have a rationale, you have numbers to back it up, and you can tell the residents why you voted for it or not voted for it and go from there. But right now, this is a big change compared to what's been done in the past, and I do think it has to be phased in. So I guess if we're done, we can, we can talk about that if you want to think, or Steve, if you have anything on that.
Well, I would just, maybe when we get together next time, if Linda could be there, maybe there's some questions. I would have one on this internal equity. I don't have my mind wrapped around this yet. And I could really use her help in a real world example on how this would work within our own city. So something like that. During the next meeting, have her explain.
I think we have a consensus here that we would like to speak with Linda, that we all need help with internal equity, because I don't know that I definitely have it down either. So If Mayor Thornton and Bola would see to trying to schedule another workshop with all of us and with having Linda there, you know, the sooner the better would be great. And then that way we can take a breather from the topic, you know, let the budget set in, see what other goals we have in the budget, and then, you know, revisit, like we said, parts of the compensation study over time, you know what I mean? So that we're not, well, one, we're, like I said, we're not being punitive and changing everything all at once. And again, there's nothing to say that we have to change things too, you know, but we do have to just make sure that we know what the market's doing and that we know what we're voting for and why. And if we think it's to keep everything and keep them at top, and we think that provides the best employee, you know what I mean? We just have to be able to tell each of our residents why we voted the way we did.
I just want to reiterate again that I do place a good amount of value in us being able to talk openly about this tonight. And I know that it was on short notice, and I, for one, I'm sure all of us would be thankful to the mayor for coming last minute to be here as a chairman of the meeting. And I guess in terms of the questions that perhaps Maureen, if you have this hard copy, you can email to Bola and maybe some thoughts about the things that we were looking for tonight, and the mayor could speak with her as well.
I think what would be good is if each of us, you know, within the next, you know, 4 or 5 days, whenever we hear back about the next meeting,
sure.
But if we could take time to collect our thoughts and then try to put in writing to Bola, it doesn't have to be, you know, that if you have a question that you want to ask of Bola supervisors, Linda, whoever that may be, if you could write those questions down so that then when we get there, they have the necessary materials that we need for that meeting. And like you say, sometimes it just takes a while to collect your thoughts and figure out a way to, you know, present what you want. And there's a lot of data, too, that we've been given on those drives and stuff that are somewhat helpful.
The only change I would offer into that suggestion is that I'd like to recognize the fact that I don't think Linda can turn on a dime and answer those questions and provide the data. And I know from talking to the mayor in past months that he spent, and I think you spent too, quite a bit of time preparing for that first workshop. And the materials that we were provided were quite extensive and actually very helpful. And so I don't know that the time crunch is necessarily there. I would like to meet, and I would like to gain some additional information from Linda, but I would want to recognize the fact that I don't think she's going to be able to say, field, you know, a dozen questions and then say, well, I'll have something to you by Monday. I mean, I think that's, it's going to take longer than that. And we ought to be prepared to let that process, you know, let it get set up. But with that in mind, I would be interested in attending more of that.
Well, perhaps if we set a deadline for ourselves to supply the questions too, so that we're not open-ended and then, you know, someone's supplying questions at the end that, you know, so if by Monday of next week, I think that would give us ample time to think over the weekend. And
we did, we all of us, or maybe, I don't know if all of us did, but there was an email somewhere that I saw. And if you could relay that, if you want to relay this to Bola, or I can relay
you
to
can
Bola
relay.
And
That's
Mr.
Fine,
Mayor.
Tom.
Andy Leahy, and also taking into consideration Alderman Slusser's vacation schedule, I feel like I heard the 30th and or the 1st of October, the 30th of September or the 1st of October were 2 days that I think everyone can make as a next option.
I can't.
You cannot.
My daughter's getting married on the 3rd. I can't.
Yeah, no, you can't. You got to be there for rehearsal dinner.
She's getting married on Saturday, but Thursday night we've got family.
And we've got to be there.
But yeah.
Well, there's a job for Octavia, I guess.
That's exciting.
Yeah, it is actually. Thank you.
And to that end, Maureen, I don't think that there was an email that we saw from Alderman Leahy regarding whether or not we could instill some of our findings within this year's budget. I believe that we can. Maybe not all of them. Maybe we'll do some of them gradually. But I don't think there's any reason why we have to wait for next budget year to do anything that we have come to an agreement on this year, as long as it's before December, the whatever the first meeting is in December.
I mean, I think if we could just address the step versus market, and we can address the, internal equity issue, and right. you know, maybe that's simple. Maybe she can explain it in a way, right. having us all kind of pulled it apart. Maybe she's got an answer that is simpler than we think. And if we could get those things, I think we could just move forward for this year with that. I think that would give staff enough direction. But
with that in mind, I'd make a with no disrespect, I would make a motion to adjourn, but I will
make that motion.
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded that we adjourn the meeting. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We stand adjourned.